Marijuana has had a complex history in the United States, dating all the way back to the country's earliest settlements. Before jumping into the legality of marijuana specifically, it is worth highlighting America's drug policies leading up to the narcotics bans enacted in the early 20th century. Before these restrictions came to be, many banned substances were unavailable or widely unused. However, that period came to an end, first with the introduction of opium and its derivatives, heroin and morphine, followed by cocaine, marijuana, and amphetamines. According to PBS, Americans have used drugs since the colonial era. In the 19th century, marijuana was widely available in pharmacies, and no one seriously questioned its medical utility. According to The Lancet, in addition to use on the battlefield, morphine and its cousin heroin were also used as child cough suppressants. Medical societies even advertised heroin as a safer, less addictive morphine alternative.
People using drugs was something that was just ordinarily accepted.
Meanwhile, German doctors noticed that soldiers who used cocaine suffered less fatigue. And it didn't take long for that same powdery substance to be repurposed for recreational use by wine manufacturers and film crews. With the ubiquity of drugs, addiction rates skyrocketed, particularly among women in both America and Europe. As this issue persisted, a handful of governments entered into a compact to regulate the drug trade, according to the Office of Justice Programs. Congress embraced this mission by enacting the 1914 Harrison Narcotics Tax Act, which forbade unregistered parties from producing, importing, or distributing cocaine and certain opiates outside of medical purposes. Marijuana, unlike cocaine, heroin, or amphetamines, has been known since Jamestown, the first successful English colony on the American continent. According to PBS, hemp, the plant from which marijuana is derived, was excellent for making sails, rope, and clothing. In the antebellum South, it was a plantation cash crop. An 1862 issue of Vanity Fair even encouraged recreational use of the drug for its calming and medicinal qualities. So how did this drug become the target of stringent federal bans? There are a few different versions of the story. Some believe that the eventual banning of marijuana in 1937 was the result of newspaper tycoons like William Randolph Hearst spreading stories about marijuana use causing violence and tragedy to befall the American people. This rhetoric led 26 states to criminalize the drug before federal bans even surfaced.
Marijuana, the burning weed with its roots in hell.
The competing explanation is that the restriction had more to do with business than public health. According to the book NAFTA and Neocolonialism, petrochemical giant DuPont had just patented the synthetic fabric nylon, with considerable investment from men like Hearst and Treasury Secretary Andrew Mellon. Reportedly, hemp was a cheaper alternative to nylon, which rendered the new fabric unprofitable almost immediately. Whether the eventual restriction was enacted in the interest of public health or filling the pockets of large corporations, it's undeniable Hearst's media machine had a hand in the ban. Regardless of his real motive, Hearst began to publish stories painting cannabis in a negative light, blaming Mexican migrant laborers in particular for reportedly bringing the substance into the country. Though we may never know the whole truth behind its origins, the 1937 Marijuana Tax Act banned the drug's use recreationally, without any exceptions for medicinal use. As the Drug Policy Alliance notes, the 1970 Controlled Substances Act placed marijuana as a Schedule I drug, despite its previous medicinal use. But some, such as the famous stockbroker Irvin Rosenfeld, swore that the drug kept them alive. According to Vice, Rosenfeld was diagnosed with a painful bone disorder, typically treated with high doses of strong, presumably addictive painkillers. In the ferment of the hippie-dominated college campuses of the 1970s, Rosenfeld discovered that he could control his pain more safely with marijuana, claiming to be pain-free after smoking a handful of joints. He linked up with another user named Robert Randall, who had controlled his glaucoma with homegrown marijuana as well. Randall and his wife were arrested in 1975 for growing hemp and promptly sued the U.S. government on grounds of medical necessity, with the help of a UCLA study that scientifically analyzed the effects of cannabis use on glaucoma symptoms. In response, the FDA created its compassionate IND program for marijuana. Simply put, anyone demonstrating a medical need for marijuana could apply with a doctor's sponsorship for an exemption. Their experiences would be documented and serve as research, while Uncle Sam sent these patients government-sanctioned joints. Although the program only approved 13 applications before it ended, activists realized medicinal use was a surefire road towards legalization. Subsequent battles over marijuana took up this issue before recreational use came to the fore. Much like the gradual ousting of marijuana from the U.S. in the mid-20th century, the initiative to nullify the federal ban on cannabis began with states working toward medicinal legalization. According to Britannica's ProCon, between 1979 and 1982, 24 states and Washington, D.C. legalized medicinal marijuana. 10 other states followed, but their new laws were either repealed or expired over time. Much of these medicinal exceptions resulted from the fact that the 1970 Controlled Substances Act allowed doctors to use illicit substances in medical and scientific research with federal approval. As a result, doctors in several states began prescribing the drug in the name of cancer and glaucoma research, while others attempted to downgrade marijuana to a Schedule II substance when used for medical purposes.
And what it boils down to is we've ended up with no enforcement. And so that means it's like it's being legalized.
While recreational and medical marijuana remained federally illegal, these acts throughout the nation paved the way for much more widespread change in the coming decades. In 1996, California became the first state in the country to enshrine medical marijuana in state law. The development came in the wake of intense national debates over the war on drugs. In the 1980s, the Reagan administration escalated the drug war with increased penalties for possession and distribution, as doctors frequently prescribed marijuana for terminally ill AIDS patients. By 1991, San Francisco had already passed Proposition P for AIDS patients to obtain the drug. 5 years later, Proposition 215 made legalization statewide. According to Britannica's ProCon, Proposition 215 passed with 56% of the vote for an open nullification of federal law. From there, as Drug Policy Alliance founder Ethan Nadelman reports, the otherwise liberal Clinton administration began speaking out against the motion, strengthening Reagan's commitment to the drug war. Ultimately, Bill Clinton was rowing against the current. As ProCon notes, seven states and Washington, D.C. followed California with effective medicinal legalization by 2000. In the latter half of the 2000s, six more states legalized medicinal marijuana, including Colorado and Vermont. According to the 1996 LA Times, the Clinton administration initially threatened to send the DEA after doctors and dispensers, arguing that medicinal use was a front for full-on legalization. Despite these assertions, studies had already proven marijuana's medical value, and before 1914, few disagreed. For this reason, doctors argued that it was impossible for them to fulfill their oaths if they were forced to refuse medicinal marijuana to a terminally ill patient under the threat of federal prison and loss of medical licensure. Matters changed in 2009 with the election of Barack Obama and the Ogden Memo. The document reversed previous federal policy, noting that if physicians prescribed and dispensaries distributed marijuana in accordance with state law, the DOJ would look the other way. However, in 2011, according to Reason, the Obama administration changed its tune and began raiding dispensaries, even if they were not involved in organized crime. In the end, Congress stepped in to curb DEA activities. The 2015 Robert Carfar Amendment was slotted into that year's Senate Appropriations Bill and passed. Although it did not stop the DEA from engaging in marijuana eradication programs, the amendment stripped the agency of some of its anti-marijuana funding. This meant that the DEA could no longer use funds from states where medicinal marijuana was legal to target registered providers. Today, medical marijuana is legal in most states, and federal government has increasingly adopted a hands-off approach in the face of popular support. Recreational weed, however, was a separate battle that began in earnest in the 70s with the Schaefer Commission. The commission noted that penalties under the 1970 Controlled Substances Act were overly harsh. In turn, according to the Nixon tapes, the Nixon administration was determined to crush the counterculture movement of the 1960s, with whom marijuana smoking had become heavily associated altogether. Richard Nixon viewed the introduction of marijuana to American society as a plot to bring down the country, and even accused Jewish psychiatrists of conspiring to spread cannabis use through the nation's population. In an attempt to produce a more even-keeled approach to marijuana persecution, the commission made several suggestions to the Nixon administration that would render marijuana's legality more similar to alcohol. Nixon ignored all of these requests, and it once again fell to the states to enact change. One might expect that California would have been the first to legalize cannabis, and they did try. 1972's Proposition 19 would have at least decriminalized small amounts of marijuana for personal use, but it was crushed at the ballot box, 67% to 33%. Instead, it fell to Oregon, which decriminalized possession and downgraded it to a civil violation in 1973. While getting caught with weed could still result in a fine, these new laws spared the violator prison time and a criminal record. While some feared that decriminalization would lead to an increase in usage, especially among minors, a study by the Connecticut General Assembly revealed that the number of first-time users and arrests fell almost 60% from 1976 to 1990. This statistic proved to many that outright criminalization would not solve the problems the Nixon administration feared. The 2000s and 2010s saw a host of states and municipalities decriminalize the drug. As research by the New York ACLU demonstrated, decriminalization just made sense when considering the consequences of marijuana arrests. According to the New York State page, a criminal conviction for marijuana possession shows up on criminal background checks that can affect future prospects for employment, housing, personal finance, and benefits. The Atlantic noted that although marijuana is used among rich and poor alike, the latter are often slapped with much tougher sentences. For this reason, a teenage act of rebellion can become a barrier to future social mobility and a better life. While there are plenty of discussions to be had over personal responsibility, the statistics have suggested that locking people up is probably not the answer. For this reason, many states have been moving towards legalization in recent years.
You know, back in the day, marijuana was a cause. It was a symbol of defiance. Now it's just a commodity.
Today, the major question rests upon the overt legalization of marijuana. The movement got its impetus in 2012 when both Washington State and Colorado legalized the drug in violation of federal bans. As of 2023, 20 states and Washington, D.C. have legalized recreational use of marijuana. The drug is increasingly popular, and celebrities and tech moguls like Elon Musk use it openly. Medicinal marijuana was easier for the feds to ignore, since users were mostly terminally ill patients that otherwise would have suffered. Recreational use, however, was another story. While decriminalization was often local authorities looking the other way on marijuana possession, legalization was a direct nullification of federal bans on marijuana. State-level legalization also raised much discussion about reevaluating marijuana status as a Schedule I drug. As a result, in 2022, Congress introduced a bill to lift the federal ban and its associated penalties. So what are the arguments for legalization? In an interview with the cannabis magazine High Times, former Republican Congressman Ron Paul argued that legalization is best from a policy and personal freedom perspective. Paul purported that, much like bootlegging in the Prohibition era, the drug war perpetuated cartel violence over the profitable American drug market criminalization created. The retired politician explained that marijuana legalization at the state-level law is a pro-freedom compromise that well balances the interests of users and society. Paul argues that legal marijuana will result in a more socially responsible society if accompanied by proper regulation. He believes that Americans have the right to use marijuana, but that individuals should be ready to face consequences if the influence of the drug leads to criminal behavior. In the same way that few argue for outright prohibition when someone receives a DUI conviction, crimes committed by some marijuana users should not impact the drug's legality as a whole.